risen indeed.
Christ has risen.
He is risen indeed.
On behalf of the Mars Ministerium, I'd like to welcome you to this worship experience here in Adams Park on top of this beautiful hill, looking out as dawn breaks. We gather to bring glory to his name. We gather to worship him, and we gather to say thank you and hallelujah. Today is a day that the Lord hath made. Come together, let us worship and adore him.
A reading from the Gospel of Mark. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where the body was laid. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on, the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll the stone away from us, from the entrance to the tomb?" I wonder what that morning was like. I wonder if it was still chilly. I wonder if the birds were just starting to sing as they are now. In the nighttime, the world gets a little quieter. Sometimes we hear the odd owl or the rustling raccoon. But before the dawn, life is quieter. There's hazy shadows all around us, and we're not really quite sure what's out there. We're not sure what's before us in the coming day. Maybe the dew is still frosty just before the dawn. But even in this quietness, even in this stillness, there is a vibration of life happening. There is an anticipation. There is the possibility that exists in the unknown. And then dawn breaks. The shadows fade away, the birds become louder, and we start to see life as we know it come to life. And on this day, we celebrate this new creation. On the Sabbath day, God rested. And then on the next day, God began a new creation in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so today, we celebrate this new creation, this new day, as this new day is breaking and as this dawn is dawning. Remembering that the dawn is just the beginning of a new day, of a new life. So today we celebrate this new creation in the waters of baptism, the waters that bring life. And with great joy, we celebrate this day of days, this beginning of the Easter season, filled with hope, joy, and the anticipation of the new life that is before us.
Come, let us celebrate this new day. Faith, hope, and joy are alive. A new age is dawning, and death has been defeated. God of all creation, God of resurrection.
We praise you.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Alleluia, Christ is risen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Thank you.
invite you to jump up just one section to the prayer of the day and to join me in that. Glory to you, O God. Yeah. And I'm confused as well. I thought there was a section before this. So let's join together. You can speak the bold portions. I'll speak the non-bold, but we'll start together. Glory to you, O God. In the beginning, you created all that is. You created life and its fullness across the earth. You called your creation good and created it for good. But creation fell through sin, and death and pain and toil spread across all the earth. Despite our actions and the actions of our ancestors, you planned to redeem your creation and to free it from the fall. On Good Friday, you won victory over sin through your Son, our Lord Jesus the Messiah. On this day, you won victory over death, raising Jesus from the grave and giving us eternal life. Glory to you, O Christ. Through your teachings, you taught us how to live. You brought life to many through healing, casting out demons, the multiplication of food, and even bringing life back to Lazarus. For us and for our salvation, you overcame sin and death and opened the gate to everlasting life. Glory to you, O Holy Spirit. You lead us into all truth. You bring us life through the opening of our minds to Scripture, your intercessions for us in prayer, and your gifting of the church for leadership, service, and the invitation of others into your people. Glory to you, O Blessed Trinity, now and forever. Amen.
I invite you to join me in the thanksgiving for baptism. We praise you, O God, for water. We need water to drink, to wash, to grow. Your creation needs water to be renewed each spring.
We praise you, O God, for water.
And as we hear the sound of water amongst your creation, we remember our baptisms, giving thanks for your gift of grace and mercy, for how you have welcomed us as your own in these waters, and shower upon us the gift of renewed life in you.
We praise you, O God, for baptism.
So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work.
the word of God from Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, brought spices so that they might go and anoint Jesus. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" And when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. And as they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for the terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. They were afraid. And frankly, I can't blame them. Just think about this for a moment. You and I, we know all about Easter. We've been decorating eggs and eating chocolate bunnies and marshmallow peeps and jelly beans all of our lives. Most of us also know all about the true Easter. We know about Jesus' resurrection in the tomb. But Mary Magdalene, Mary, Jesus' mother, and Salome, they didn't have a clue about any of these things. All they knew is that they had gotten up early, they had gone out to Jesus' tomb to offer one final act of service to this man whom they all loved. Some of you, I suspect, have made similar journeys to your loved one's grave. We go there to pay our respects, to tell them how much we love them, to do something tangible for them, to clean off the markers, to trim the grass, to sit and just to talk, to simply be with our loved one. And we do that, we make those journeys to the cemetery with certain expectations, the most important of which is that when we arrive at our loved one's grave, we expect that it will be there undisturbed. So imagine your horror if when you got to your loved one's grave, instead of a nicely raked mound of dirt covered with flowers, what you found was a kicked over tombstone and an empty hole in the ground. Imagine what thoughts would be going through your mind. And then as you're running through the cemetery frantically trying to find some sign of your loved one, hoping that you'll find the body, you come upon a young man sitting on one of those concrete benches in the cemetery who says to you, "Don't be alarmed. Your loved one's okay. He's not here because he's been resurrected from the dead." How would you feel? What would your reaction be? Terror? Shock? Anger? Fear? Would you even believe the young man? That's probably how Mary Magdalene and Mary and Salome were feeling. I suspect they were afraid to believe, but also afraid not to believe. Remember, you know about the resurrection, but this is all new and very frightening territory for them. I can imagine them as they were trying to compose themselves and trying to make some sense of all this, asking one another, "What was it that guy in the garden said again? That Jesus has been raised? What does that mean?" And then pondering that a while, could it really be true? That death is not final? That there is life after death? That young man also told Mary Magdalene and Mary and Salome that Jesus would be going ahead of them to Galilee. He said, there you will see him, just as he told you. And again, I can envision them asking one another. Could that have been what Jesus was talking about a few nights ago in the upper room when he said, do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not be afraid. In my Father's house, there are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. Could we really be with Jesus again? Will our eternal dwelling place really be with God? And if so, where will that dwelling place be? Up there? Somewhere? Or will God come down here? And if it's down here, will the earth be changed too? Will there be a new heaven and a new earth? What might that be like? Better than what we have now, that's for sure. And won't that be wonderful? I read an article once that observes we live in a Good Friday world. That's true, isn't it? We live in a world of brutal terrorism and endless wars and starving children. We live in a world plagued by prejudice and racism, greed and injustice, corruption, addiction, disease, and even worse. It's all around us. There's no denying that. But as that same article proclaimed, we are Easter people. We are Easter people. The Lord has risen. Let us never forget.
I would invite you now to join me as we enter our time of prayer for our renewed creation. Now, as we do this, at the end of each section of the prayer, I will say, these are the thoughts and yearnings of our hearts, and your response will be,
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
And at the end of the prayer, I'll ask that you join me as we recite the Lord's Prayer together. Now, I know different churches use different versions. I just want to warn you, I'll probably use the version with trespass and trespasses. So we're all on the same page. Let's pray for the renewal of God's people, for our churches, and for our world. Grant, Almighty God, that on this most blessed of mornings, we may grow into a deeper knowledge of your plan and purpose for our lives and for our world. Help us to both understand and incorporate into our daily lives the glory of renewal and new life. Just as you raised your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, from the grave on that first Easter, raise us also into new life. These are the thoughts and yearnings of our hearts.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Lord God, we pray that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in this, our world. May all the followers of the risen Lord Jesus become the salt and light that our world so desperately needs. These are the thoughts and yearnings of our hearts.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Guide the peoples of this land in the ways of justice and peace. That we may honor one another and serve the common good. May the peace of Christ reign not only in our lives, but in the life of our many communities, that unity may overcome the divisions that plague our society. These are the thoughts and yearnings of our hearts.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
And just as we pray for our own land, we also pray for nations around this world, that they too may be guided by your strong hand into the ways of justice and peace. We especially remember the people of Ukraine and the people of Israel and Gaza, where war and conflict continue to bring misery and suffering. Strengthen the hand of those who work for peace and frustrate the plans of those who choose evil. These are the thoughts and yearnings of our hearts.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Bless all of those whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that the members of our families and our community of friends may all come to know the presence of Christ in their hearts and lives, and that all these may also experience the miracle of new life. Grant that we may serve Christ as we serve them, and help us to love one another as Christ loved us. These are the thoughts and yearnings of our hearts.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them into the joy of your salvation. May the same power that raised Christ from the dead be present with all who suffer disability or chronic disease, all who are currently hospitalized or ill at home. Raise all into new life and grant them your gifts of healing, health, and wholeness. These are the thoughts and yearnings of our hearts.
Lord, in mercy, hear our prayers.
May your healing power and presence also be with those who struggle with the ravages of addiction or the pain of mental and emotional illness. May your resurrection power be present to carry them through their most difficult days and bring them to victory over that which binds them.